Behold how good it is, and how pleasant when brethren dwell in unity.
This week's Torah portion covers Exodus 21:1 to 24:18. Pharaoh has let the Israelites go. They are encamped by Mount Sinai, eating manna and quail. They are entering their seventh week of freedom. God is about to call them into covenant and appoint them as a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. They are poised and ready to receive the pinnacle of divine revelation. And yet this particular section of Exodus never makes it into children's Bibles. I have a very large library of children's Bibles, and every single one skips right over this section and jumps to Moses receiving the stone tablets on Mount Sinai. I suppose children prefer the Ten Commandments written on stone in their straightforward manner, but I want to spare adult listeners. We have much to glean from listing out of the civil laws that will govern the Israelite society. The laws of Exodus 21 apply more to man's relationship with fellow man than with God. Not completely, but mostly. They are laws that ensure Israel will be a just society. Some of the laws pertain to slave ownership and admittedly have a cringe factor. Rabbi Telushkin commits that although the Bible is radical and uncompromising in its battle against idolatry, it is evolutionary rather than revolutionary in regards to slavery. Slavery is permitted in the land of Canaan, even though the entire Exodus narrative up to now has been anti-slavery. Still, the biblical laws are evolutionary in that they require a more humane treatment of slaves than what was provided by their contemporaries. For example, if a slave owner beats a slave to death, the punishment for the slave owner is also death. This is an early indicator that in God's eyes, all humans are to be considered equal. But for centuries, the Bible was easily used as justification for slavery as frequently as it was used to provide arguments to end it. Other laws in this portion of Exodus pertain to personal property and family obligations. Some of the ordinances read beautifully and easily lay the foundation for the nation, which is designed to be a light to all other nations. Like, do not mistreat or oppress a foreigner, for you were foreigners in Egypt. Other laws go into detail about the consequences that play out if a man's bull gores another man, and what happens if someone's donkey falls into a pit. Exodus 23 lays out the three annual festivals which Jews are commanded to keep: the Feast of Unleavened Bread, Festival of Harvest, and the Festival of Ingathering. Though the stone tablets Moses receives on Sinai state simply to keep the Sabbath, this chapter gives shape to Sabbath keeping. Sabbath is not just meant for the Israelites, but also the foreigners in their midst and the slaves. Even animals require rest. Along with the feast, Exodus declares that the land is intended to be on a seven-year Sabbath cycle and allowed to rest every seventh year. The land Sabbath laws were not obeyed for almost 2,000 years that Jews were living in exile. Only now that Israel is a nation in their land again have they been able to safeguard the agricultural cycle laid out in the Bible. Nestled into the chapter about holidays and Sabbath keeping is a command to not cook a young goat in its mother's milk. That one sentence has come to occupy a major place in the dietary life of any kosher Jew. The separation of all milk and meat stems from this command and is fully elaborated in the Talmud. In Jewish tradition, this moment in space and time, after the Exodus, but before the golden calf, was the high point of the Israelites' unity and obedience. Firstly, the revelation at Sinai was unique. Until now, God has intervened in the world through individuals, speaking directly to Adam, Noah, and Abraham. But for the first and only time in the biblical record, God appears before all the people. He manifests his full glory before them. Hundreds of thousands witness the Sinaitic revelation. And when Moses tells the elders of God's laws, the people respond, "All that the Lord has spoken, we will do." The acceptance of the covenant was unanimous. May we today have our own Sinai moment. Shabbat Shalom.
Behold how good it is, and how pleasant when brethren dwell.